All right, so I've been talking about distributed machine learning, and I guess as you guys, so classic machine learning basically is focused on learning in the situation where the data is all in one place. But in many modern machine learning applications, we often have data distributed across multiple locations. For example, data from large-scale scientific experiments or large stores of video and image data. In such cases, in order to do learning over the combined data, there is need for communication. So basically, in such scenarios, communication becomes another key resource in addition to the classical resources in machine learning, which are computation and human labeling effort. Okay, and this is what my talk is about. So in this talk, basically, I'm going to present some of the recent work that we've been doing, both in the context of supervised learning and unsupervised learning. And in this context, basically, we analyze communication as a key resource for performing the corresponding learning tasks. And I'll start with the first talk on supervised learning. Actually, this was the first paper, so this called 12 paper 3 years ago, was the first paper that in machine learning looked at communication as a key resource. And since then, many papers have followed up on it and really tried to analyze communication. OK, cool. So I'll start with supervised learning here. And just because this is a slightly bit, is a bit of a broader audience, I'm just going to spend 5 minutes, or actually 3 minutes, to just recap the usual way to analyze supervised learning in centralized settings. And then I'm going to talk about our results for distributed learning. OK, and in particular, in this part here, I'm just going to look at supervised classification, so binary classification. So for instance, problems of type classifying whether an email message is a spam or not, or whether certain, whether a given object is a chair or not. OK, now there are two very nice and widely studied models for thinking about such problems, the statistical learning theory framework of Babnik and the PAC model of Valiant. And in both of these frameworks, we assume that we have an underlying distribution over the instance space, for instance, underlying distribution over the space of unlabeled examples. So for instance, a distribution over the all possible email messages. And then we assume that in the training phase, first, a random sample of these examples are labeled by an expert, for instance, as being spam or not spam for the spam detection problem. And then this set of labeled examples are then given as an input to a learning algorithm, which then produces a hypothesis function that is used to classify new subsequent examples that come from the same underlying source. Okay? So for example, if our algorithm represents each email message by features measuring, say, counts of various keywords, then we should place each email message as a point in RD. And then what our algorithm might find is a separator separating spam emails from not spam emails in that feature representation. OK, so more formally, in the training phase, we assume that the algorithm is given a set of polynomially many labeled examples. These examples are assumed to be drawn IID from some fixed but unknown distribution over the instance space. And we assume that they are labeled according to some fixed but unknown target function, C star, for example. OK, and then the goal of the algorithm is to do some optimization over the given set of examples. And what we want to do is to output a hypothesis function that then does well on new examples that come from the same underlying distribution. So we want to generalize well. Okay, and by doing well, we mean we want to output a classifier of small error. And for my talk, the notion of error that I'm going to talk about is the classic 0-1 loss or classification error loss, which is just defined as a probability that my hypothesis or classifier predicts differently from the target function on an example that comes random from the same underlying source. Okay, now the classifier that we find, like this one here, we're going to come from some class of functions, which I'm going to call C. And now the case where the target function itself belongs to the class, it's called the realizable case. So that's the easy case. That means we model the problem perfectly right. And the case where the target function is not in the class, it's called the agnostic case. And in that case, the best we can hope to do is to compete with the best classifier in that class. OK, cool. So that's the formalization. And within just one slight recap, within this formalization, the two main questions that people typically study in supervised machine learning are the algorithm design question, basically. So designing polynomial time algorithms that dwell on the observed data. So that's like a classic algorithms question. Okay, and then, and obviously this has been widely studied, and we have very successful techniques like boosting SVM and so on that have impacted the world. Now, the second and equally important question that we study in machine learning is the sample complexity or confidence bounds or generalization guarantees, which basically quantifies how many training examples we need to see in order to be confident that a rule that does well over the training set will also do well in the future as well. Okay, and this is again super well studied, for instance, for many years. So for example, I have here on my slides a sample complexity from the 70s, which says that if the class of functions that we are looking at has more VC dimensions, has finite VC dimensions, say D, then if any classifier that is consistent with D over epsilon, log 1 over epsilon plus 1 over epsilon, log 1 over delta random examples, will with high probability at least minus delta output an epsilon. So any such classifier will with high probability at least 1 minus delta will have epsilon error rate at most. So we'll have small error rate. Okay, and this is for realizable case where the target function belongs to the class. In diagnostic case, you just have to replace 1 over epsilon, 1 over epsilon squared. And there are many, many more refined bounds here. This is just the basic one. We can replace this dimension with Rademacher complexity and so on. Okay, so this is super well understood for centralized supervised machine learning. Okay, but as I mentioned at the beginning of my talk, often in modern machine learning, the data is distributed across multiple locations. And in such cases, what we want to do is to learn low error hypothesis with respect to the overall data distribution by using as little communication as possible. Okay, so for instance, we might have various hospitals with various distributions, several hospitals with various distributions of patients, and we might want to learn a classifier that identifies a common misdiagnosis. Okay, or we might have some various research groups that have collected data. And we might want to learn a classifier over the combined data. And again, we want to minimize communication. Okay, and so basically, motivated by such questions, we had this model for distributed machine learning, which the way we thought about it is as follows. So we assume that basically we are thinking about scenarios of this type that I just described, where the data is inherently distributed. So the data comes inherently distributed. So we have a number of, we have multiple holders of data, and each holder has a piece of the overall data pie, like in my picture here. And obviously, in order to do learning over the combined data, we have a need for communication. And we want to come up with learning techniques that use as little communication as possible. So basically, in such scenarios, communication becomes a key resource in addition to computation and human labeling effort in the classic machine learning. Okay, so a little bit more formally, so we assume here that, for now supervised classification, so we have as typical an instance space, and we have, say, S players. I chose S because then I'm going to talk about clustering, and I'm using K for K-median, K-means, and so on. Right, so we have S players. And each player I has its own distribution of data that can he can sample examples from that underlying distribution. And those examples get labeled according to some fixed unknown common target function C star. And then the goal of the algorithm is to output a hypothesis function that approximates the target function well with respect to the mixture distribution. And let's assume uniform mixture for now. Okay? So obviously there is need for communication here in order to achieve this. And just as typical in the in classic machine learning, we're going to assume that we fix a class of function C, and the case where the target function belongs to the class is called the realizable case, and similarly, we're going to have the diagnostic case. And let's assume that the VC dimension of our concept class C is D. And let's also think about the case when, I guess, for the results in this original work, the results are most meaningful when somehow the number of players was much smaller compared to D, where really D was a key quantity that we're trying to minimize. Okay, cool. And so basically the main question here is how can we design communication efficient learning techniques that use as little communication as possible? And we care both about the total communication and about the number of rounds of communication. And obviously, if we are in situations where efficient algorithms exist for the centralized case, we also want to be computationally efficient. Cool. So now that's the scenario. And actually, just to better explain a little bit the scenario here, let me mention one very simple case. So imagine that we have two players, and that one of them has the positive examples, and the other one has the negative examples. And so the question that we're asking here is how much communication do we need in order to find the classifier that does well over the combined data? So notice that we are not interested in finding a classifier that does well over each player's data set, because here this would be trivial, right, in this specific case. So we really care about finding a classifier that does well over the combined data, so we must communicate. Okay, cool. So that's the framework that we looked at in this work, and within in that paper, basically, we formalized the problem, and then we looked at we provided some generic upper and lower bounds on the amount of communication needed in order to learn well. And we also looked at some very broadly applicable communication efficient distributed boosting implementations. And we also provided tighter results, because this was a cold paper. We also provided some tighter results for specific classes of interest to learning theory, like parity functions, decision lists, conjunctions, and so on. So we provided results that are even better compared to these more generic results that are more broadly applicable. Okay, and we also looked at privacy and so on, but for the purpose of this presentation, because I also want to talk about clustering, I'm just going to focus on the middle part here, and I'm going to talk about this communication-efficient boosting implementation. Okay, but before doing so, just to set up the expectation that we're even looking for, let me mention a couple of very basic baselines, simple baselines that we're trying to beat significantly. Okay, so the baseline number one here is, say, in the realizable case, or the target function does belong to my concept class, one simple way to do learning is the following. We're going to have each player send 1 over s, s is the number of players, times d over epsilon, times log 1 over epsilon examples to player 1. Which then does, and that player then aggregates the examples and does the computation. And that, so for example, outputs a classifier that is consistent with all the labeled examples. Now, notice that this player is going to get d over epsilon examples from the mixture distribution. And if these examples are indeed IID, then we would be done by the classic sample complexity statement that I mentioned earlier. Okay? Now, these examples are obviously not quite IID, because in particular, I get the exact same number of examples from each player. But it turns out that if you look at the math, the standard double sample trick for the from the visit dimension theorem we're going to go through in this scenario, and everything is fine. So we're able to learn here with one round of communication, and by using d over epsilon times log 1 over epsilon labeled examples of communication. So these many examples are communicated. D over epsilon, that's the main quantity. And one round of communication. Now, for those of you familiar with learning theory, let me mention one other basic baseline, which is for the case where for our concept class we have a mistake-bound algorithm, like perceptron for linear separators with large margin. Okay, so here turns out that we can learn a good classifier by using m rounds of communication and m examples and hypotheses being communicated. And the way we do it, again, player one does a computation. In each round, player one broadcasts its current hypotheses. And if any of the players has a counterexample, it just sends it to player one. And then player one updates the current hypothesis using the mistake-bound algorithm, and everything repeats. Okay, and then if you are familiar with mistake-bound algorithm, you're going to immediately realize that, sure, yes, here we can learn well by using m rounds of communication, where m is a mistake-bound, and m examples being communicated. Okay, okay, cool. So then basically the first baseline, the simplest baseline, has linear dependence, if you go back, has linear dependence in D on 1 over epsilon, where epsilon is the desired accuracy. Oh, and by the way, of course, this one also can be implemented in the agnostic case, right? And similarly, the other one, the mistake bound. Okay, cool. So the first baseline has linear dependence in 1 over epsilon and D, where D is the visit dimension, while the second baseline has, this is in the number of examples being communicated, while the second baseline has no dependence on 1 over epsilon, but depends linearly in m, the mistake bound. Okay, and sometimes m could be very large, so the natural question is, can we do much better? Okay? Yes?
So far, only one player needs to know the classifier, right?
Well, you can broadcast it. So, and anyway, in all my examples, I mean, ideally, yeah, it's once one of them learns it, then you can just broadcast to all the others. One more step, yeah. Yeah. Sure. Yeah, I mean, all the other, it depends on the scenarios. In some scenarios, you want it's okay for the player one to know the classifier. In some of the scenarios, you might want that everyone knows the classifier. But it's minor communication at the end, just send one hypothesis to each player. Okay, so the question is, can we do much better than these baselines? And the answer is yes. And the interesting fact is that yes, we can do actually improve exponentially over the first baseline in one over epsilon quantity. And we can do so by using a communication efficient implementation of boosting. Okay, and I'm going to describe the result for the realizable case, which is in the original paper. We also can handle now diagnostic case. This is newer work. Okay, so just to recap, because I'm not sure, just one slide recap of what boosting is and what ADA boost is sufficient for my presentation. So what is boosting? Boosting is an algorithmic technique for turning a weak learning algorithm into a strong learning algorithm that is able to produce arbitrarily accurate hypotheses. Okay? And so what is how is boosting operating? So, right, and actually just to be concrete here, I'm going to describe ADA boost, which is a specific weighted based boosting algorithm, one of the most popular algorithms. Okay, so the input to ADA boost is a set of labeled examples and the weak learning algorithm A, and the output will be an arbitrary accurate classifier, as accurate as you want it to be. Okay, now how is ADA boost operating? It proceeds in rounds. In each round, we have a distribution DT over the set of examples, well, the set of our examples, so we're weighting over those examples. And in each round, we run our algorithm A to produce a weak hypothesis HT, which we then use to come up with a new challenge distribution for our weak learner for the next round. Okay, and so in particular, in the first round, the distribution is uniform over these examples. And then in round T, we use the hypothesis round T, right? Obviously, first run our weak learner algorithm on the distribution DT to get a weak hypothesis HT. And then we use this weak hypothesis HT in order to create a new challenge distribution for round T plus one. And how do it? Well, we're going to increase the weight. It's very natural. We're going to increase the weight on the examples on which my current hypothesis HT is incorrect, and just decrease the weight on the examples on which the current hypothesis is correct. Yeah? And the specific formula is here. The good news is that the details are not important for this presentation. What is important are the following 2 points. Okay, so what's important for getting this to be a communication efficient implementation is are the following 2 facts. So fact number one, it turns out that if you think about the way ADA boost operates, at each round T, the weight that my algorithm has on any example Xi depends entirely on the performance of the hypothesis, weak hypothesis that have been generated so far, H1, H2, HT minus one, on that specific example Xi. So basically, the weight that I have on an example Xi depends entirely on the performance of my hypothesis weak learners generated so far on that example Xi, whether it was wrong or correct, plus the normalization factor that can be communicated efficiently. Okay, so that's one good fact. And another good fact that is going to allow us to implement this in a communication-efficient manner is that to achieve weak learning, we only need order of D examples. So to find the weak learner, basically by using the classic sample complexity statements, because now weak learning means I only want to do better than random guessing, so my epsilon is a constant, I only need order of D examples. Okay, so now with this, basically here is the communication efficient implementation of boosting. So as we do, we're going rounds. I mean, the key idea is that we're going to let the players reweight their own distribution internally and just send just the relevant information so that basically the center can find a weak learner, and then the center just sends back the relevant information so that the players can reweight their own distribution. Okay? So in particular, basically, here is the way things go. In each round, first each player sends player one enough data so that player one produces a weak hypothesis. So in particular, in the first round, each player sends the over S examples, where S is the number of players. Then the player, the center are going to have ordered these samples at random, right? So that should be sufficient to find the weak learner. Okay, so in each round, at the beginning of each round, each player sends player one, which is, going to think about it as a center, sends player one enough data so that he produces a weak learner. Then this player does the computation, finds a weak learner, and then he broadcasts this weak learner to the other players. Okay, and then each player I then uses weak learner HT to reweight its own distribution, to reweight over its own data set. And then he computes the current sum of the weights on its own data set, and then he sends the sum of the weight to player one, which then uses these weights to then determine how many examples to request from each player in the next round. And in particular, the way our center going to do, we're going to request order of the examples from the multinomial given by these weights, local weights. What we prove about this form of the distributed implementation of AdaBoost, we prove that basically for any concept class C of VC dimension D, we can achieve an epsilon accurate classifier by only using log on over epsilon rounds and the order of the examples communicated per round. So basically in total, and plus some order lower order terms of communication. So basically in total, we learn a concept class D with this dimension D by only using D log on of epsilon examples being communicated, which is exponentially better than the baselines that I presented at the beginning. Okay, and the proof really follows from properties of AdaBoost. So the main one being that in order to achieve error epsilon, because I'm implicitly assuming a weak learner that has a constant edge over random guessing, I only need log on of epsilon rounds to achieve error epsilon in AdaBoost. If you guys know, in the realizable case, basically have an exponential decay in the error rate with the number of rounds, so basically I only need log on of epsilon rounds. Okay, and per round I only need order of D examples only because order of D examples are sufficient to find a weak learner, so then this basically finishes the proof. Okay, cool. So this is for realizable case. So AdaBoost it's basically analyzed typically for it's only for realizable case. Now in diagnostic case, I'm not going to go into details, but I want to mention in the original paper actually it turned out that we had some results based on some on a connection to interactive learning. So in interactive learning, we're trying to I think I have more minutes because I started late. Okay, cool. So in interactive learning, right, we are trying to minimize the number of labor requests, the interaction with the experts. We are trying to be very efficient from the communication point of view. If you think about it, then this somehow shows that you could use interactive learning procedure to, you can determine distributed learning procedures where you are trying to minimize communication. And based on such a connection, we provided some results for the case on C is finite in the original work. And in more recent work with a student at Georgia Tech, Shang, we are able to basically give a distributed implementation of smooth boosting, which is a boosting procedure that is tolerant to noise. So the problem with these boosting procedures that are tolerant to noise is that they have a 1 over epsilon. Most of them have a horrible dependence on 1 over epsilon. It's not logarithmic. And so if you just naively use the existing boosting procedures that are tolerant to noise, you're not going to win over the baseline. So it was quite tricky to get one that is tolerant to noise, has agnostic properties, and has logarithmic dependence in 1 over epsilon. But we can do it now, which is nice. OK, so that's a general purpose, basically, way to handle, to come up with communication efficient algorithms for supervised classification. Now, I'm not going to go through this. In the paper, as I mentioned, we also have more tighter results or tight results for specific cases. For example, for intersection closed concept spaces, where we have better results that I'm going to skip right now, and or for parity functions, this is an interesting case where if you are forcing the algorithm to be proper, in other words, if you are forcing the algorithm to output a classifier that belongs to the original concept space, if we are forcing the algorithm to output a parity function, basically, then we need probably omega of d squared bits of communication. But if we allow improper learning, then we can learn with only order of bits of communication. It means also bits of the distributed boosting implementation by a factor of d. Okay, so that's kind of cool. The technique here uses some cool tricks from learning theory. Okay, but I'm going to skip this and just summarize and say that in that first work, this was the first time where in machine learning, we took communication as a key resource and provided some very general algorithms and also more specific algorithms for specific cases. And the good fact is that actually this work then generated a lot of follow-up work. So people like Martin Wainwright and Michael Jordan and their students, John Ducci and so on, started to prove lower bounds on communication in this context. Okay. Cool. So that's supervised learning now in the last 5 minutes. I also want to mention some recent results on clustering, some other results on distributed clustering. And all of this is joined with Bruce, my former student, who is right here. Okay. So here, basically, the question is very similar. Now we're going to think about k-median and k-means clustering. I'm sure that this audience is very familiar with that. So for example, in k-median, we are trying to find k-centers, c1, c2, ck, and clusters, right, in order to minimize the sum, right, to identify k centers in order to minimize the sum overall points of the distance to their closest center. OK, Okay, and the result is also okay. Means, so I'm trying to minimize the sum of the square distances. Okay, cool. So these are widely studied in, I guess, in centralized case. We're looking, for coming up with communication efficient distributed implementations, the key idea of our work was to use corsets. Okay, so what are corsets? Actually, they come from TCS. So they are very natural objects. They are just short summaries capturing the relevant information for our problem with respect to all possible clusterings that we care about. Okay, so more formally, right, so if you have a set of points S, then an epsilon corset is just a set of points with weights. It's a such that for any possible set of centers with k clusters, the weighted cost for that set of centers on the corset is a good approximation for the cost overall. It's within 1 plus minus epsilon, the true cost. Okay, and this is true for all for any Voronoi partitions with k clusters. Okay. Now, corsets have been studied, right, in TCS. And the key idea is to use them in distributed settings. And why are they nice? Because, let me actually just mention that in centralized case, so for instance, one construction that we build on, and I think this is one of the most recent ones and one of the best ones, is due to, in the centralized case, this is the construction by Feldman and Lernberg. And here, for example, for K-median, it turns out that you can find an epsilon corset of size kd over epsilon squared, where k is the number of centers, d is the dimension of the space where the points live in, and epsilon, I guess, is accuracy in the corset construction. This is parameter over here. Okay, cool. So in the centralized case, we can find corsets of size kd over epsilon squared. Now, if you think about in a distributed scenario, one simple solution would just be to do distributed clustering, would just be to have each player communicate its own corset, right? So each player computes a corset over its own data and communicate a corset. And it turns out that union of corset is a corset. So you could have each player find the corset, communicate it. You get a union of the corset, which is a corset of the overall data. And you just run an approximation algorithm over that corset. And you're guaranteed that you're going to do well, right? Now, the problem is that if we do so, by combining local corsets, that works, but then the number of examples of communication will be S, the number of players, times kd over epsilon squared, the true size of the corset. So basically, the number of examples that we communicate increases multiplicatively by the number of players over the true size of the global corset, because we know that the union of the data set is a corset of size kd over epsilon squared. So the question is, do we need that multiplicative increase by a factor of the number of players? And the answer is no. It turns out that if we use a two-round procedure, right? So this basic procedure is a one-round procedure, but it increases the number of examples by a multiplicative factor of the number of players. But if we use a two-round procedure, then we get a communication complexity, which is exactly the true size of the union of the data set, so which is essentially what we want. Okay, and I think I have spent 2 minutes to describe the high-level idea. So what we build on is we look at the specifics of the corset construction of Feldman and Lernberg, and we adapt it to our distributed setting. Okay, and so the way that construction works is as follows. First, so in centralized case, what we do, we first find a constant factor approximation with respect to the given objective, and we add the centers of the constant factor approximation to the corset. Okay, and if you think about it, this is already a very coarse corset. Okay. And then what we do is sample kd over epsilon squared more points according to their contribution to the cost of the constant factor approximation that we found in the first round. So we do adaptive sampling, and we sample points according to their contribution to the very coarse corset we find in the first round. Okay, and why is this working? Because, well, at a high level, if you think about it, by the way, I'm reformulating. This is not the way they present it. It's an interpretation of the result. Okay, now why is this working? Well, because if you think about it, we can upper bound, so for any possible point P, for any set of centers C, we can upper bound the penalty that our point P pays under the set of centers C by using some triangle inequality. We can upper bound it by the cost that our point P pays under the constant factor approximation that we found in the first round. And then this immediately suggests doing this adaptive sampling. Because of this upper bound, it immediately suggests doing adaptive sampling according to the cost that each point pays to the constant factor approximation. In order to prove correctness, then we can just, in a way, reduce to the classic VC dimension type of argument based on uniform sampling. Okay, so that's basically the Feldman and Glenberg construction kind of reinterpreted. Okay, but now this interpretation is nice because then it tells us what to do in the distributed setting. And here what we do, basically the key idea would be, right, of course, we cannot hope to find a constant factor approximation over the union of the data sets because this is kind of the problem we want to first solve. But instead what we show is that it's sufficient to kind of do the sampling in the second stage, adaptive sampling in the second stage, in a way that depends only on the cost of local constant factor approximation. So by using constant factor approximation to the local data sets. Okay, and that would work. And in particular, here is basically the construction. Each player, I, so it's a kind of a two-stage distributed learning, distributed clustering procedure. First, each player, I, finds a constant factor approximation and just sends the cost of that constant factor approximation to the center. Okay, and then the center, we're going to sample kd over epsilon squared points, where this is the true size of the core set of the union of the data sets. And the way it samples is according to the multinomial given by the costs of the local constant factor approximation. So for example, if the cost of, the player one is very small, kind of the original centers of a constant factor approximation are already very good representatives for the data set. So we're going to sample much less from that specific player. Okay? And then basically, right, so here the center tells each player how many points to send, and in total he's going to ask for kd over epsilon squared points from the servers, and then each player sends enough points to each player sends enough points to the center, and the way he samples internally is according to the cost of its local constant factor approximation. This is how he samples points internally from its own data set. Okay, and then if you go through the typical sampling arguments, and you can prove this works well. Okay, and it works well in theory, and it also works well in practice. So Bruce did experiments here, and he showed on real world data that basically this two rounds procedure at the same communication cost achieves better accuracy compared to the combined, the basic procedure where you just combine local core sets. Okay? So the same communication cost we do by 20 to 30% better consistently on most of the data sets. Okay, so that's nice. And I'm not going to have it on my slides, but I just am going to say in words. So this was the NIPS 13 paper. We had a subsequent NIPS 14 paper where we did it even better. It has 4K means. And in particular, it turns out that 4K means, in order to solve the K means clustering problem, is sufficient to project the data onto the K over epsilon squared largest eigenvectors and then solve the K means problem there. And so we're motivated by this, and we came up with a distributed implementation of PCA, right? And then we use it as a pre-processing step to this algorithm here. Okay, and then to do the distributed PCA, we then played all sorts of tricks to also make it fast, with like subspace embeddings, what David Woodruff has been working on, and so on. And so at the end of the day, we got in this NIPS 14 paper kind of scalable algorithm for distributed clustering. Okay, cool. So basically, I think I'm over time, so let me just summarize. So in the original work called 12 paper, and then in the subsequent work, we looked at communication efficient algorithms for supervised classification. This is what I presented in the first part of my talk. In the second part, I talked about communication efficient algorithms for unsupervised learning, clustering, and PCA, mentioned PCA. Now, there is a very interesting technical open question here, which I would be very curious to see solved. So in the second part, my technique was based on core sets. Okay, and I did the best one could hope if what we do is use kind of the core set viewpoint. Right? But then my dependence, if you go and look back, my dependence on the number of examples that I communicated is kd over epsilon squared. So it's one of quadratic dependence, it's at least linear dependence on number of epsilon. So it's quadratic dependence for k-median, actually it's even worse for k-means. Yeah? While for supervised classification, my dependence on number of epsilon was logarithmic. Because I was doing boosting and I used log over epsilon rounds, and I was able to somehow learn with only d log over epsilon examples of communication any concept class of VC dimension d. For clustering, the best we know currently is this bound over here for k-median. So I think it would be a very interesting question to see if one can use kind of a boosting style procedure to improve our these results here, or these core sets results here. think that would be really the interesting technical question. So actually, after our work, Vahab, did he speak here? So he also had work on corsets, but all of those results are pretty much of this order. I mean, so they're as simple as this one. So I think it's a very cool technical question to somehow do it, to somehow manage to use boosting style ideas and to drastically reduce the communication. Because there is no reason to believe that we cannot go beyond that if we're somehow smart and use some other summaries than corsets. And of course, more generally, it would be cool to kind of look at all learning problems and to come up with very refined trade-offs between all the resources involved, communication, computation, sample complexity, privacy, and all the other externalities you guys care about. Okay, cool. Thank you. So, questions? Solutions to this question?
Very few lower bounds.
So that's I think that Mark was going to talk about lower bounds. I don't know if they apply to this setting, right? So people have what I talked about, I assume the data is inherently distributed, right? Now there is another model that is popular in machine learning that I'm also currently working on, or you parallelize data, basically do random partitioning, for example. I think that for that model, people have shown lower bounds. It's what Martin Wainwright and Michael Jordan and Yu Chen and Zhang have looked at. I think even for this model, there are some lower bounds, actually. So there was, Bruce, you might have read that paper. So there was a paper posted on, after I gave this talk at FCRC, somebody posted a paper with lower bounds for clustering. I sent that to you. But I don't think they are very strong lower bounds. I think they are kind of the weak lower bounds for clustering in particular. Oh, yeah, and for learning, okay, so for learning, we had some lower bounds, but they are not very strong. So, I mean, in the original paper, you can notice, right, so I gave D log 1 over epsilon upper bound here. Right, so this is a generic is D log 1 over epsilon upper bound for realizable case. You can argue that in the worst case over the mixture distribution, in the worst case over the target function, D log 1 over epsilon is needed. But we use kind of epsilon cover based arguments, and they are not as strong. So we had some lower bound in our original paper. For supervised classification, there have been lower bounds for related models, random partitioning. I think we need Mark to come up with more lower bounds. And he's coming up next.
All right. Thanks.
Other questions? OK, cool. Thanks.